final regular lecture is entitled The Anatomy of Nerve Compression in the Upper Limb. It's about the course of the major nerves in the upper limb and what might go wrong by compression, perhaps by other causes of lesions. I will show you the complex course of nerves in the upper limb, also explain why the course sometimes is so complex and unexpected. And I will show you several potential so-called entrapment points. These are points where nerves might become compressed. I will explain everything, we go through it slowly. It has some little bit of specialized information as well, which is very useful for surgeons in this area to understand the compression points. So this is not necessary anymore, you know this all. You know that I'm standing there behind these windows waving at you, so I don't have to mention it again, we all know that. Okay, so first I start with some general aspects, why the course of the nerves in the upper limb might be a little bit complicated. And then I've chosen three major nerves running in the upper limb, nervus radialis, nervus ulnaris and nervus medialis. We go through all three of them. I will show you the course, function, what can go wrong, and a little bit about the clinical symptoms. Let's start with the basics. I'm pretty sure that you know how nerves exit the vertebral column. So this is one of the thoracic vertebrae, and you know that between each pair of vertebrae on the left and right side, a spinal nerve is emerging, exiting this vertebral canal. The spinal nerve is this one, it's a fusion of the ventral root, which contains motor information, and the sensory root, which contains sensory information. So this is called nervus spinalis. So all along the length of the spine, you'll find on the left and the right side a spinal nerve between each pair of vertebrae. So this means that totally we have 31 pairs of spinal nerves. Once the spinal nerve is outside the vertebral canal, it divides in two branches. It has normally a tiny dorsal ramus, dorsal branch, and what's in the name, it goes to the back for motor supply of the muscles of the back, but also for the sensory supply of the skin of the back. And there's a ventral branch, a ventral ramus, which normally is the bigger of the two. And then something special happens, because on several levels, namely on the cervical level, so it means the level of the cervical vertebrae, and on the level of the lumbar vertebrae, and on the level of the sacral vertebrae, a reorganization takes place. A network, a plexus, is formed, consisting of those ventral branches. And also, I'm pretty sure you've heard about the cervical plexus network, which is made up of the ventral branches of the spinal nerves of segments C1 to C4. Nerves emerging from this cervical plexus are important to supply structures in the neck, but also the phrenic nerve, which runs through the diaphragm, originates from the cervical plexus. So the phrenic nerve has a long course to run before or until it reaches the diaphragm. The brachial plexus, important for supply of the upper limb, so that is the major subject of this lecture, it is made up of ventral branches from the spinal nerves C5 to partially the first thoracic spinal nerve. And then we have a lumbar plexus, which runs from L1 to L4, important for innervation of the groin, you know, the inguinal region, and also the lower limb. And the sacral plexus starts with L4 to S4, is important for supplying the pelvis and also lower limb. But we are missing something. We are missing the thoracic levels, most of the thoracic levels, because the thoracic spinal nerves do not reorganize. the ventral branches of the thoracic spinal nerves, they do not reorganize, they just retain a segmental course because they become the intercostal nerves, which run between the ribs and which are of importance for supplying the muscles of the thoracic and the abdominal wall, and also supply of the skin of the thorax and the abdomen. So when we go back to the previous image, now we can recognize that this is on the thoracic level because we see the lungs over here, that the spinal nerve has a tiny dorsal branch, this one, it goes to the back, you see it supplies the muscles of the back, and this branch it continues to the skin for the sensory supply of the skin, and this is the larger ventral branch, which in this case does not reorganize because it's a thoracic level, and it becomes the intercostal nerve. Now we go to the brachial plexus, because this one gives rise to the nerves, the major nerves which run into the arm. So the brachial plexus is made of the ventral rami C5 to T1. So these are those ventral branches. They form three so-called trunks, a superior trunk, a middle trunk, and an inferior trunk. Each of these trunks divides into a ventral and a dorsal division. That's happening over here. From those divisions, three cords are formed. We call them in Latin fasciculi. They are called fasciculus medialis, fasciculus lateralis, and fasciculus posterior. And from these three fasciculi, the five major peripheral nerves of the upper limb arise, and these are the ulnar nerve, nervus ulnaris, median nerve, or nervus medianus, radial nerve, or nervus radialis, axillary nerve, nervus axillaris, and finally, musculocutaneous nerve, the nervus musculocutaneus. So these are the major peripheral nerves, but there are many more branches which are given off by this complete plexus. So you see how complicated it is, this reorganization. It's very complicated. These fasciculi are arranged around the axillary artery in the axillary fossa, as we can see on the next slide. So first you can see the trunks, the cords are in close contact, close connection to the first rib and the clavicula. They might sometimes have some compression over there. The fasciculi are arranged around the axillary artery, and this gives them their names, because this is the fasciculus lateralis, lateral to the axillary artery. This is fasciculus medialis. We cannot see fasciculus posterior because it's behind the axillary artery. So this is about the plexus formation. Now we should know just a little bit about the formation of the muscles in the arm. So, did you study embryology? Do you know what the somites are? I think so. So you may remember that somites finally will divide into myotomes, dermatomes, and sclerotomes, and the myotomes will form muscles. So what happens in the fifth week of development, the so-called upper limb bud will occur, and some cervical myotomes, which of course have myoblasts, these are the precursors of the muscle cells, they invade the upper limb bud and they will form the muscles in the upper limb. Here you can see that there is a ventral muscle mass and a central, a dorsal muscle mass, because also bone formation gradually will take place. So the muscles will form different masses. One mass on the ventral side of the bones, and eventually this ventral muscle mass will become the flexor muscles and also the pronators. The dorsal muscle mass will form extensors and supinators. Of course, these muscles have to be supplied by nerves, and these nerves originate from the plexus which is formed. So also the nerves have to make a choice. Are we going to the dorsal side to go to the dorsal muscle mass? Are we going to the ventral side, ventral to the bone? We have to make a choice. So it becomes complex. We have a plexus formation of nerves. We have ventral and dorsal muscles. Somehow they should combine. And then something else is taking place. And those of you, and I know that several of you have, were on the previous lecture this morning. I explained a little bit about development and evolution. For those who were not there this morning, I will do it again. Because during evolution, rotation of the limbs occurred. So if you have a look at a crocodile, for example, you will see that his knees are pointing outwards. In a similar vein, the elbows are pointing outwards, and it's how such a crocodile is moving, in this way. Now, during development and, during evolution, and our development is a kind of replication of this evolution, we see that the upper limbs, the arms, undergo a lateral rotation. And this means that the flexion side will be on the ventral side. Simultaneously, the lower limbs will undergo a medial rotation, which brings the flexor side on the dorsal side. So this rotation means that the nerves, which are developing, somehow have to accommodate this rotation. And it really explains the complex and the spiral shape of the dermatomes, you know, the dermatomes, in the upper and the lower limbs, whilst in the trunk they retain a very nice segmental position. It can be seen over here. Well, you know, a dermatome is an area of skin which is supplied by one spinal nerve. And there's a lot of variation in dermatomes. There's a lot of overlap. You can find various dermatome maps in the literature. The best known are the ones proposed by Förster, somewhere in the 40s of the previous century. This one and this one. And they're mainly based on clinical signs. They very well match neurological symptoms. Whilst the ones composed by Kierkegaard and Carrot are closer to the original embryological development. Well, whatever the truth is, I think the most important message is there's a lot of overlap and variation in dermatomes. Now, I made this introduction just to make clear how many complex things are going on in development. We have seen a lateral rotation of the upper limb. In the same time, muscles are developing, have to choose their position in a ventral or a dorsal muscle mass. And the same holds true for the axon which invade these muscles. So in the end, it may happen that in a final, let's say an adult configuration, the nerves, the course of the nerves, is not always the best possible course because so many events have happened during development. I will give you two examples. You may know that nervus radialis is very important. Well, its function actually is supply of the extensors of the arm. So it supplies triceps brachii and also the extensor muscles of the wrist and of the hand. So it means it's important that this nerve is on the dorsal side of the upper limb. Otherwise, it will not be able to reach the extensors. But somehow, during this development and rotation, here it lies on the ventral side of the elbow. And this means that the branch, it's the deep branch of nervus radialis, which should supply the extensors of the wrist and the hand, it should try to reach a dorsal position in the arm. And therefore, and I will demonstrate it better in the course of this lecture, this branch is going through a muscle, to reach this position. Also the nervus ulnaris, the ulnar nerve, for example, supplies some of the flexors on the ulnar side of the forearm, so it should have this ventral position. But here you see the same nerve, it's lying posterior posterior of the medial epicondyle. So somehow it should go through a muscle to get its ventral position back. So these courses, these passages through muscles, are potential entrapment points. Now we come to see the three major nerves and what happens to them in the course and where they can get damaged. We start with the nervus radialis. This is a dorsal view, and this is where nervus radialis emerges. It goes through a hiatus between a few muscles and the humerus. And this is already an important thing, because it means that when you have a fracture of the humerus, there's a possibility that the radial nerve gets damaged. That may happen. It's a well-known complication of a fracture of the humerus that you have a lesion of nervus radialis. Also, it's possible that when some external pressure is applied on the arm, that there's compression of the radial nerve against the humerus. I will come back to that. It supplies triceps brachii, and furthermore, it supplies extensors of the wrist and the hands, but I already explained that. Now, what can go wrong? I've summarized that here. First, you might have a humerus fracture, which lesions the radial nerve. Second, you might have compression of the radial nerve against the shaft of the humerus. Strange enough, this is called Saturday night palsy, because you might be under the influence of alcohol, you might fall asleep with your arm resting on the armrest of a chair. The classical story is you are drunk, you're getting home, walking through the park, you're sitting on a bench in the park, you're falling asleep while your arms are just on the support of the bench, and there's external pressure on your arm, and the radial nerve is pressed against the shaft of the humerus, and therefore it's called Saturday night palsy. People who invented these terms have had a very rich imagination and fantasy, I think. There's also, because it has to course through a muscle, I will show you that later, supinator muscle, a so-called radial tunnel. Whatever the course is, if there is a lesion of the radial nerve, extensors of the wrist and the fingers will not function anymore. Therefore, it's called a wrist drop, or dropping hand and dropping fingers. That's the clinical picture of a lesion of the radial nerve. Generally, the triceps brachii is not involved unless the lesion is very, very high, because the branches to musculus triceps brachii are given off very proximally. Okay, now let's have a look at this course of the radial nerve through the musculus supinator. So we have seen already this picture, where the radial nerve is on the dorsal side of the arm, and then somehow it goes through an intermuscular septum to reach the ventral sides of the elbow. And we know that the branch which supplies the extensor muscles of wrist and hands should reach a dorsal position, and therefore it is going through a muscle. It can be seen right here. It's a deep branch, ramus profundus, also called the posterior interosseous nerve, nervus interosseus posterior, which goes completely through musculus supinator. This has happened here because this is a dorsal view, and then it has reached the dorsal sides of the forearm to supply the extensors of wrist and hand. There's a superficial branch as well. It's here. It's on the deep surface of the brachioradialis muscle, and here you see it becomes lies superficially to give the sensory supply of a part of the hand. The course of the nervus radialis through supinator muscle, including the part before that, is called, especially in clinics, the radial tunnel. So this is a left arm ventral view. This is the nervus radialis. There's a division in the superficial branch which lies underneath this musculus brachioradialis. This is the deep branch, which is crossed here by an artery. This artery is a branch of the arteria radialis. And then here it reaches musculus supinator. It goes through the supinator muscle. And you see here the same in a real anatomical specimen of our dissecting room. This is a superficial branch which lies underneath brachioradialis muscle. This is a deep branch which is going into the supinator muscle. Now we take a similar specimen and we zoom and we see a few interesting things. So this is nervus radialis. This is a superficial branch. This is a deep branch. First we see how it is crossed by this branch of the arteria radialis. Quite often it's not a single branch but a series of arteries, and when it's a series of arteries it has been given the name the leash of Henri, and this series of arteries might compress, so it's a potential compression point or potential entrapment point. Then it enters musculus supinator. This is musculus supinator. And this entrance is called arcade of Frose. It's a typically clinical term. It's all right if you forget it immediately. Later on, when you are a plastic surgeon, you will learn that name again. Just to indicate that these specific pieces of anatomy have been given very special names. But the important thing is that in 30% of the cases, this edge, the entrance into the supinator muscle, is tendinous. And when it is tendinous, it's harder, and then again, it's a potential compression point. Also, where it leaves musculus supinator over here, sometimes this distal edge of the canal inside the supinator muscle is tendinous, and therefore this is a potential entrapment point again. So this may happen. It's not extremely rare, and it's something that especially the specialists should know. And for now, I think it's very important to realize how complex the course of nerves in the arm is, and that sometimes courses are followed which are not so logical, but it's just a consequence of development and the many events that were taking place. Ulnar nerve is equally as impressive. Nervus ulnaris. Functionally, it's important to supply some muscles on the ulnar side of the forearm. These are muscles which work on the wrist joint, especially the ulnar side, for example, flexor carpi ulnaris. But also the deep flexor parts for the fourth and the little finger are supplied by nervus ulnaris. And furthermore, there's a deep branch over here which completely runs through the hands and supplies many intrinsic hand muscles, one of them being musculus adductor pollicis. We'll see that. Now, what may happen? No, I go back. First, you see here that the nervus ulnaris is lying in a dorsal position, dorsal to the medial epicondyle. You all know that, of course, because you can easily feel it, you can palpate it. If you go to the medial epicondyle, you can feel the nerve rolling behind the condyle. And if you knock your arm, you know this funny feeling, this tingling feeling. In English, it's called the funny bone. In Holland, we have a different name for that. And that's just something that may happen. But therefore, you may imagine that if we have a fracture of the elbow, that may cause a lesion of nervus ulnaris. In a similar vein, if you have much pressure in the elbow region, for example, patients who are in bed all the time, bedridden patient, or when professionally related, when you're sitting at the reception desk and constantly moving or handling the phone, it may give so much pressure that you might have a lesion, a compression lesion of the ulnaris, of the ulnar nerve as well. Nervus ulnaris has to move from the dorsal side to the ventral side, close to the elbow. So it's passing through a kind of muscle again. So it's a kind of a tunnel. We call it the cubital tunnel. I will show you. And then, close to the hand, it has a very specific tunnel, which is called Guillon's canal. It's important as well. Now, what happens if you have a lesion of nervus ulnaris. When you realize that nervus ulnaris, to begin with, it supplies the so-called musculi interossei. Have you heard of them? These are small muscles between the metacarpal bones. These are important for making these movements, abduction and adduction of the fingers. They're supplied by nervus ulnaris. So if there's a lesion of nervus ulnaris, those muscles will expose atrophy. And therefore, you see this hollowing between the bones. It's a sign. Also, the typically claw hands, which is related to a position of the fourth and the little finger. And I will explain you in the next slide what is the cause of this claw hands. Another clinical symptom is called Froment's sign. If you realize that one of the intrinsic muscles supplied by nervus ulnaris is adductor pollicis, and adductor pollicis does this. So can someone give me, can I have a piece of paper just for a few, 1 second? Okay. So if a patient has a lesion of nervus ulnaris, you ask him to grasp a piece of paper. Then he will need the function of adductor pollicis for that. Then you try to take away this piece of paper. It's not happening because I have a firm grip, because I don't have a lesion of nervus ulnaris. But if I have a lesion of nervus ulnaris, now draw again, then the patient cannot hold the paper because the adductor pollicis is very weak. And this is called sign of Froment. It's one of the symptoms of a lesion of nervus ulnaris, because there's a problem with one of the muscles supplied, namely musculus adductor pollicis. Now about this typical position of the fourth finger and the little finger. And that has to do with the presence of a musculus lumbricalis. Okay, now I'm watching into the audience. When I say musculus lumbricalis, does it ring a bell? It rings a bell, great. You know everything about it? Everything about it. Okay, I can skip this slide, wonderful. Okay, then that is wonderful, then you understand and you know that it runs from the tendon of the deep flexor muscle and it extends into the dorsal aponeurosis mechanism. And therefore, it runs on the ventral side of the metacarpal phalangeal joints, and so it can give flexion over here and it gives extension in the interphalangeal joints. Actually, you can say movements made by the lumbricalis muscles are this. This is what it does. Well, interesting. Now I can move like this. Why should we be able to do this? It's slightly more complicated. Because if you're going to make a fist, if you want to grasp something, then it's important that this grasping bow is even, regular. If we only are using the long flexors, like musculus flexor digitorum superficialis and musculus flexor digitorum profundus, you will notice that flexion will start in the distal interphalangeal joint. Then this one will follow, and then this one will follow. So you will have this. And this is not an even grasping bow. So what you need to do, you should somehow enhance the flexion in the metacarpophalangeal joints and a little bit inhibit the flexion, weaken it a little bit in the interphalangeal joint. And that's exactly what lumbricalis muscle does. It's a real fine-tuning of this grasping movement. You can have a very fine grip by that. It's really, it's a fine-tuning of the action of the long flexor muscles. Now, the third and the we have four lumbricalis muscles. The third and the fourth one, which are related to the fourth finger and the little finger, they are supplied by nervus ulnaris. So if there's a lesion of nervus ulnaris, you will have dysfunction of these two lumbricalis muscles. And the position will be the opposite. So we will find extension in MCP and a little bit of flexion in the interphalangeal joint. So it will look like this. And this is the claw hand. So the claw hand will only be in the fourth and the fifth finger due to dysfunction of two of the lumbricalis muscles. Now, let's have a look at a course of nervus ulnaris. Nervus ulnaris, we have seen it is running here on the dorsal side of the medial epicondyle, but it should reach a ventral position in the forearm. And it does so, here it is again, this is a dorsal view. It does so by going through the two heads of flexor carpi ulnaris. Flexor carpi ulnaris has two sides of attachments. We say it has two heads. One side of attachment is here, it's at the olecranon. The other one is at the medial epicondyle. And now we're going to see it from a medial direction. It will be a medial view, like this. So, elbow is in flexion. This is the medial epicondyle. This is the olecranon. This is flexor carpi ulnaris. You see it's two sides of attachments to olecranon and the medial epicondyle. There is some connective tissue strands running between the two heads, which has been called the arcuate ligaments. And on the medial side, you find the ulnar collateral ligaments. Now this is nervus ulnaris running behind the medial epicondyle, and you see it's going between the two heads, and therefore it's lying between these arcuate ligaments and the ulnar collateral ligaments. And it can be squeezed between the two ligaments, especially during flexion. You can try, because during flexion, the distance between the medial epicondyle and olecranon increases. And when it increases, there will be more tension in those ligaments. You can try it yourself. Because if you touch with your thumb the medial epicondyle, it's not so difficult. And with your index finger, olecranon, not so difficult either. And then when you flex your arm, you will notice that the distance will increase. If you have properly touched it, it increases the distance. And this means that automatically those ligaments will tighten. And that's a potential compression or entrapment point as well. This is the medial epicondyle, this is nervus ulnaris, and this is flexor carpi ulnaris, attachments to the medial epicondyle and the olecranon. So you could say this is one ligament and the gray structure is the other ligament. And you can see how the nerve is running between the two ligaments, and that's a potential entrapment point, especially during flexion when the ligaments become tightened. Now we go back here. Okay, we continue to have a look at the course of nervus ulnaris. So now we have passed the elbow region, and nervus ulnaris, it continues to the wrist and the hand, because we know it has to supply several muscles, intrinsic muscles of the hands. So when it's close to the wrists, also close to the carpal tunnel. Do you know the carpal tunnel? Is it a well-known term, carpal tunnel? Yeah. Then it's covered, nervus ulnaris, together with arteria ulnaris, by a connective tissue band. It's an extension of the fascia antebrachia. This one. And then this covering, including the more distal part of the course, is called the canal of Guillain. And I will show you in a little bit of detail. First, we're going to see a cross-section of it. So this is ventral, and this is the dorsal side. You see the carpal bones are lying in such a configuration that you have a groove, a sulcus. This is the flexor retinaculum, and this flexor retinaculum closes the sulcus, therefore it becomes a canal. Officially it's called canalis carpi. Clinically we say it's the carpal tunnel. And through this carpal tunnel, all long flexor tendons run, So four tendons of musculus digitorum profundus, four tendons of musculus digitorum superficialis, also the tendon for the thumb, musculus flexor pollicis longus. You see there are separations from the retinaculum, an extra compartment for flexor carpi radialis, and the fascia antebrachia is here, and this forms Guillain's canal, which contains nervus ulnaris and arteriae ulnaris. This already could be a potential entrapment point, but it goes further. So let's go back. Now we're going to zoom in this region, but also we turn it 180 degrees, because now this is proximal and this is distal. In this case, this is proximal and that is distal. So this is part of the fascia antebrachii, which covers nervus ulnaris and arteria ulnaris. So this is the beginning of Guillain's canal. This piece of fascia has been given a special name, but please forget it for now, that's for later. And then you can see how it continues, and the nerve divides into two branches. A superficial branch, which is sensory for part of the hands, and this is the deep branch, and this one is important for supplying the intrinsic hand muscles. And you see it's crossing a ligament and seems to disappear somewhere over here. Let's have a look. I think this is a nice drawing to illustrate this. You see there's a ligament running between the pisiform bone, which is one of the carpal bones, and the hamulus of the hamate bone. The hamulus is just a processus of one of the carpal bones. So this ligament is called the pisohamate ligament. And it's the deep branch which disappears here. And quite often, the muscles over here have an origin on a fibrous band, which also runs between the pisiform bone and the hamulus of the hamate bone. So this fibrous arch is not always present, but most people have it. And this is, it's a tough structure. So if this happens, and the deep branch is disappearing here, this is really a potential entrapment point as well. So that may be a cause of compression of nervus ulnaris and can eventually cause the claw hands. Finally, we go to nervus medianus. Nervus medianus is important to supply the flexors of the wrist and the hand. It has a pretty coarse in the middle of the arm, therefore it's called nervus medianus. It also supplies several intrinsic hand muscles, especially on the side of the thumb, and also the first two lumbrical muscles, and as a sensory supply as well. There are two important sites, well three actually, for entrapment. The first one is related to the course in the upper arm, actually here. Because when there's external compression on your arm, it may also compress the nervus medianus. And this has been called lover's palsy. Why? You're lying in bed with your lover, you're falling asleep, and the head of your lover is resting on your arm. And then when you wake up, you have a lesion of the nervus medianus. It's called lover's palsy. When it comes to lovers, you should use French, so the term paralysie des amoureux, c'est mieux, it's better. So that's one cause. Another possibility, so is where it runs through or between two heads of pronator teres muscle, and I will show you. And finally, it can become compressed in the carpal tunnel, and then you have the carpal tunnel syndrome. So the clinical picture is especially exemplified by the so-called preacher's hand. And this is related by the fact that nervus medianus supplies complete flexor digitorum superficialis with all four tendons to the fingers. But only part of flexor digitorum profundus, which runs to the first and to the second finger. So this means if you try to flex your fingers, you can still flex your little finger and your fourth finger, because part of flexor digitorum profundus to little finger and fourth finger is supplied by nervus ulnaris, and that's still working. But you cannot flex, almost flex, not, and you cannot flex anymore the index finger and the middle finger, and therefore you will have this configuration, like a priest. It's called a preacher's hand. It's also called the oath hand, because when you swear, I don't mean it in the meaning of cursing, but in making an oath, you can do like this. So it's called preacher's hands or oath hands. It means you cannot flex these fingers anymore. You still can flex a fourth finger and the little finger, and that's related to the function of the nervus ulnaris. Now, let's have a look at the two potential entrapment sites. So first, we see nervus medialis, it enters the elbow region. It's lying next to arteria brachialis. It runs deep to the aponeurosis of the biceps, which also is called Lacertus fibrosus. And then, this is the left side. On the right side, we have a deeper view. So we have removed part of the biceps muscle. This is the biceps tendon, by the way, running to the radius. And now you can see this muscle is pronator teres. It's this muscle. It has two heads. So the biggest head, it comes from the medial epicondyle, but there's a smaller head which attaches to the ulna. So this nervus medialis is running between the two heads. And that's a potential entrapment point as well. And also, for this case, we have made an animation of our model. Must be this one. So, to start with, ventral view. Again, biceps aponeurosis, arteria brachialis, nervus medialis. We'll start. So now we're removing a few muscles to see it better. And then we can see this is pronator teres. This is the head which comes from the medial epicondyle, and the other head, it comes from the ulna. And you can see how the nerve goes between the two heads of pronator teres. Potential entrapment point. But of course, the best known compression area for nervus medialis is the carpal tunnel. I just explained about this groove, this sulcus, due to the shape, the configuration of the carpal bones, which is covered by this flexor retinaculum. Therefore, we have a tunnel called the carpal tunnel. And again, on a similar cross-section, you see the course of the deep and the superficial flexor tendons, tendon of flexor pollicis longus. And now, very important, it also contains nervus medialis. So there it can become compressed if you have, for example, some inflammation. If there's not enough space, you can have compression of nervus medialis. And if you consider the area of sensory supply of nervus medialis, you can have paresthesias, tingling sensations in these parts of the hands. So, what's therapy? Not so difficult. Just release it. Just take a knife and make an incision in the flexor retinaculum, and then you will have created the space to relieve the patient from pain and the paresthesias. So, this is a model of the hand and the wrist, which we've made in our own department in Utrecht. And the latest development was to make very user-friendly software. So this is it, and you can see I can easily rotate the hand. I can translate it. I can zoom out and I can zoom in. But I would like to show you the course of nervus ulnaris first. So we have to make the skin transparent. There it goes. Let's zoom a little bit more. There it is. So nervus ulnaris, it must be this one. I click on it, yes. We have some information. It's still in Dutch, but we're going to produce an English variant as well. If I zoom in a little bit, oh, too much. Now you can nicely see this nervus ulnaris, how it continues. This is flexor retinaculum. This is musculus palmaris longus. This is nervus medianus, and these are the long flexor tendons. So this is already the covering of the carpal tunnel. But this here, we are already in Guillain's canal. Now, zoom out a little bit, because the hidden course of the deep branches, this is a deep branch of nervus ulnaris, is visible. And it might be useful to fade the other structures like this, because now you can see how the deep branch is running through the hand, especially if I rotate, you can appreciate the three-dimensional configuration. If I show the related structures, you will see nervus ulnaris together with the muscles which are supplied by it. So it's a very nice view. So I explained the claw hands, and I explained it by this function of the lumbricalis muscles. By the way, this is musculus adductor pollicis, which is supplied by nervus ulnaris, and when it dysfunctions, it causes Froment's sign, which we demonstrated together with your piece of paper. So I think I'm going to try to find one of the lumbricalis muscles. So this is another possibility. We go here. I think first I go to the complete model again. Let's zoom out, it's too much. This is better. So let's try to find musculus lumbricalis. Yes, let's have a look at the first one. There it is. It's here. Now it is in green. So let's fade the other structures, then we can see it better. And now let's try to rotate a little bit. Not so easy. Yes, I think this is nice. Because now you can see. Let's try to rotate better. Yes. Now you can see how it's. Now, first I go to the related structures, because now you can see how it originates from the deep flexor tendon and how it extends into the extensor mechanism, into the dorsal aponeurosis. But when I go to the fade others option, you can see it's running ventrally to the metacarpophalangeal joint, so it's causing a flexion over here. And because it extends into the dorsal aponeurosis, it can extend the interphalangeal joint. So that's a very nice thing to see as well. So we go to model reset. I think now it would be nice if we could have a proper look at the carpal tunnel. So we see it a little bit over here. Let's try to zoom. So this is very nice. We're looking inside the carpal tunnel. So this is palmaris longus. Let's zoom a little bit. This is palmaris longus. These are the long flexor tendons. Flexor pollicis longus over here. You see it has a separate compartment. This is nervus medianus. And this is the flexor retinaculum. Perhaps it would be nice if we can do a dissection. It's possible. We go to the dissection room. Because this program has two basic modes. The first mode was the educational mode. I just demonstrated, because you can get information about the structure, about the course, about function. Also, for example, I forgot to demonstrate, if you go to a muscle, let's do that. If you go, for example, to this muscle, musculus adductor pollicis brevis, you can have additional information about origin, insertion, function, and innervation, still in Dutch, but finally it will be available in English as well. So I go to the dissecting mode. First we zoom a little bit, then I want to get rid of the skin. Okay, I would like to see and to open the carpal tunnel. So let's first rotate a little bit like this. Then we go to the section. I'm going to remove the upper neurosis palmaris like this. And you can see in a pop-up what is happening. Let's move musculus palmaris brevis as well. You see, this is the one I removed. We remove palmaris longus. And here you very clearly can see the carpal tunnel. This is the flexor retinaculum. And now we have a nice look at the long flexor tendons inside the carpal tunnel and the close relationship to nervus medianus. So perhaps we should go back to this position. We can zoom more. And you see, oh, you can see this is going to be a nice model for additional teaching. It is, I think, a very nice accompanying tool when you're having the practicals to study in advance at home or after the practicals that you can rehearse it again. So we try to make this model as realistic as possible. We try to make it user-friendly, and it will be accessible through a browser, so you won't need specific hardware or software. It will be accessible through a browser. It will work on PC and on Apple computers. And that brings me to the end of my lecture. So to summarize, we have seen the innervation of the upper limb. We have seen how complex it is, because in development many events happen. There's a reorganization via a plexus, and we've seen that nerves finally course along several potential entrapment points. And I've showed you several. Radial nerve, it passes through the radial tunnel, through the supinator, which can have a tendinous edge, arcana or frosa, for example. Nervus ulnaris, through the cubital tunnel between flexor carpi ulnaris heads and Guillon's canal. And finally, nervus medianus between the heads of pronator teres and the carpal tunnel. So this actually, it was the final ordinary lecture. I hope you enjoyed it, and I wish you, I want to thank you a lot for attending it, and especially you all, because I noticed so many familiar faces again. So I know that most of you have attended more than one lecture. So thank you very much for that. I'm really honored by that. Thank you.